Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you to the CCLE for having me as a speaker today. I'm a teacher for Memorial Lutheran School in Houston, a school that I look at with very much enthusiasm and excitement, as it is one of the few Lutheran schools that finds value in the classical method of education. I'd like to begin today by, first with a quick announcement. On the schedule, this is a two-part thing, and the second one starts at, I believe it's 3 or 4, oh, let's see here, 2, 3, it would have to be at 3:30, right? I have it here. Okay, so I originally scheduled an hour and a half for my second lecture because of, I was informed that it would be an hour and a half, so we'll start the second one in the lunchroom at, let's see, 3:15, and then it'll go 15 minutes past, so we'll kind of section, does that make sense? 15 minutes before, when it was supposed to start, 15 minutes after. That way, I'll have enough time to present the whole thing. It's the way that it'll work is I'll start out with a little bit of theory on it. The theory will kind of continue into the second presentation, and then it'll really end with how this works in the classroom through assignments. And we'll go through one assignment pretty rigorously together. Okay, so anyways, I'd like to begin by sharing a little bit about myself because it pertains to why I'm here today presenting on the Trivium. I spent most of my younger years in Wisconsin, Sheboygan, Wisconsin, which is a city that is an hour north of Milwaukee on the coast of Lake Michigan. It's about 20 hours north of here. I was educated in a Lutheran grade school until 7th grade when I started attending a local public school through 8th grade. For high school, I went back into the Lutheran school system and attended Lutheran High School in Sheboygan, Wisconsin. I'm the oldest of all my siblings, two sisters, and of all my cousins on both sides, almost all of which attend or have attended Lutheran schools, grade schools and high schools, for most of their lives. After high school, I attended the University of Concordia in Wisconsin for a year and a half. I left Concordia to attend Hillsdale College, for another 3.5 years, the time within which I spent a semester studying at New College of Oxford through the program through Hillsdale, where I was able to study Plato's Republic and Cicero's On Duties in a good amount of depth, as they were in Greek and Latin, two things that I studied pretty rigorously in Hillsdale. So I'm thankful to have experienced, as a student, the handful of different educational models that I have experienced so far, and the reason is because witnessing the differences between them has allowed teaching to become a passion for me, because I know exactly why I love what I love, and I'll explain what that is. So there's one major similarity that I witnessed between all of the Lutheran education that I had received and the public school that I did really enjoy being at for 2 years. And the similarity is that as a person who attends the school, and I can admit that this was definitely the case for myself, the highest value of being in school seems to be on the social experience. And this seems to be an outcome of the progressive mentality that education should be child-centered. I was watching a TED talk by a teacher who said in 29 years of teaching, the most important thing that she had learned is that every day the kids teach her way more than she could ever teach them. And everyone in the audience cheered. But this is the sort of mentality that trickles down into students being most interested about what happens in between classes. If teachers are not knowledgeable and they don't have a passion for the thing that they know must artfully be conveyed to their students, then it'll be the case that the students become the teachers. I don't actually mean to undermine this entirely, because it is beneficial for someone to be able to learn to understand the social environment and how to operate successfully within it. The persons around us are invaluable beings, and learning how to be friends with other people in different contexts is something that will make life much happier. But if the most exciting thing for a kid is the social experience, then I think that many, many public schools are not only better at offering this to kids, simply because they offer a much more diverse student body. In other words, there are many more social experiences that the child will encounter, but because it's also much cheaper to parents. If you've been in a conversation with a younger person from outside the United States who's not entirely familiar with the culture and education within the United States. Again, on the subject of schools and education, everyone, at least that I've run into, seems to think that schools in America, they're fun, a particular type of fun. The movie industry provides a great advertisement to foreign students who are looking to study abroad in the United States. Their mentality seems to be, I'll get to work on my English with people my age, and attend these magical things called homecoming and the prom. And movies, well, of course, they are a bit hyperbolic, are based on quite a bit of truth, primarily that school is, first and foremost, a social experience. So many Lutheran schools, including the ones that I grew up in, seem to have many of the kids that they do, because Lutheran or Christian parents like the idea of having their children attend a small school that teaches the faith, and non-Christian parents seem to like the idea of putting their children in an environment that seems to contain less vulgarity and a higher sense of morality than other public schools in the area. I'm not a parent, but I can still understand why these would be valuable things to parents, as I would want my children to be in a good environment that offers these benefits as well. I will say that if it were not for the experiences that I had at the end of my senior year of high school, all the way through to the end of my time at Hillsdale College, I would also be content recognizing small class sizes, the teaching of the faith, and a morally stable place, at least comparatively, as sufficient virtues for the Lutheran school system to continue running the way that I had experienced it. Okay, but it has been the last 7 years of my life that have exposed me to something fundamental, which I perceive to be missing throughout most of the Lutheran school system, and that is the student. I use the term student, not to sound pretentious, but in the Latin sense of the word sedeo sedere, that is a verb for one who is eager, more particularly one who is eager to know or for knowledge. It's annoying to me that among many non-Christians, Christians often have a preconceived reputation for being dumb or incapable of thinking beyond old stories that are irrelevant to today. Certainly this isn't fair to Christians, but it's interesting that the church historically has gone from being perceived as an intellectual powerhouse, something which must be, by outsiders, something that must be argued against, to how it is perceived today, again, by outsiders, as something to which many are perfectly comfortable remaining indifferent. I think a major underlying reason for this shift in perception is the diminishing number of real students in Christian schools today. And I think that adopting and employing the classical model of education is the solution for the lack of students in many schools, not just Christian ones. So what is classical education? Why should one consider it a solution? And how do these things have anything to do with teaching the trivium as a class? To the first of these three questions, what is classical education? I believe that somebody really attains knowledge of this best through experiencing it, because when you're a student being taught this way, you know it, and you can't imagine a better way of being trained. I think many today have a negative impression of classical education, primarily because they don't know what it is. They haven't experienced it. So verbal explanations, at the end of the day, have a tendency to sound a bit jargony. But I think there are two major parts of classical education that can be explained fairly well. The first is that it's a system where students crave knowledge, and you ask, well, how do you get them to do that? And the answer is, well, their teachers crave knowledge, and children love to imitate. Most of the time, they do it without thinking. This is why one ought to be concerned with Miley Cyrus. So I can remember the first time, though, when I required this sort of craving for knowledge. So to illustrate this point a little bit, I'll share my own account of what I mean by craving knowledge. When I was a senior at my Lutheran High School, I had a friend that I liked to converse with about many of the things around us. There's an old saying that conversations can either be about people, events, or ideas. And together we like to focus most of our conversations on ideas. In order to really do this, though, we started reading books outside of school. So there was one day that I picked up the Iliad at Barnes & Noble. I have no idea why. I started reading the first book, though, that I had ever really been hooked on. I had enjoyed reading some novels as a younger child, but this was a work that had me researching, writing up charts on the gods and what they did, the characters and their traits, and trying to figure out why I had so much admiration for the character of Achilles. This wasn't just enjoying a good book. It was almost an obsession, and for the life of me, I could not figure out, still, it's a good question, how a poem like this could be somewhat central to a civilization, kind of, very rough analogy, but kind of how the Bible has been for us. And so, how could people really have respect for some made-up idea called Zeus? It was this period of time, though, that I can identify as the spark that led me to want to know, to want to be a student of Homer. And my inquiry into the Greeks did not stop, though, at Homer. This only led me into reading Plato, as he was a person that came up time after time while researching the Greeks. And it was the character of Socrates that impressed me more than anything I had ever read before. Now, who was this pesky and brilliant character that who cared so much about things like piety and justice and wisdom? What was his deal? After reading through many works by Plato over and over again, I decided that I'd be a philosophy major as a pre-seminary student at Concordia University, Wisconsin. These ideas that seemed outside my own upbringing had caused me to want to know more about my own culture, my peers, and ultimately myself. And attending Concordia was okay. Here I had a few teachers that helped me along with what I wanted to know, but I was overall very dissatisfied with the academic environment. Primarily the attitude of my peers, many of which were in the pre-seminary program. Now, don't get me wrong here. There were many hard-working people in my class. There were many naturally intelligent people in my class. But neither of these things really makes a student. Students, though, is what I was looking for. I mean, what do I mean by this? Well, generally, assignments, readings, many class lectures, learning Greek, Latin. These seemed to be things that none of my classmates really were interested in doing. The general attitude towards these things was that they were tolerable things that had to be done, not things that we got to do. Just get past this class, and we'd be on to better things. Now, there can only be theories for why this seems to be the general attitude. I have a few of them, but what is my point? The university should be one of the easiest places in the world to find students. Think about this. No one has to be there, actually. Most are paying a lot of money to be there. Well, people are comfortable and really enjoying the social atmosphere and the new freedoms of being in college. It seems weird that if you were to walk around and ask the people that were going to class if they were excited to be going to class, or if you ask the people doing homework if they were really interested in the homework they're doing, most people would look at you as if they didn't understand what you were asking. So this really brought me to wonder, am I just a strange person? Well, possibly. But you can see here that if I were to have graduated from Concordia, and let's just say somehow I became a teacher, which wasn't actually my plan at all, even through Hillsdale, I would be a teacher that probably wouldn't dare to envision the possibility of a whole school of students actually craving knowledge, because I would never have experienced this as a possibility. So Hillsdale College, I can still remember my first month of being there, like it was yesterday. These are some of my first impressions of the college. I remember being in a handful of different conversations with students who would say things like, I got a D in Dr. Jackson's English class, but it's okay, I learned more about English than I ever thought was possible. I'd highly recommend the class. I remember going to listen to a poet that was visiting campus on a Friday evening, and the auditorium was packed full. People were standing up on a Friday evening to listen to a poet. I mean, this is a college here, right? I remember that the first college party I went to involved a three-hour conversation on Aristotle. I remember admiring upperclassmen because of their passion and knowledge about their subject matter, whether it was biology or economics or English. I remember a college president who would walk around during lunchtime and have some fun with his students by probing them on what is the good. I remember being invited to and attending many voluntary book clubs on C.S. Lewis, Virgil, etc. I remember something called the Homerathon, which is where the classics department schedules from like 7 p.m. to 7 a.m., readings of Homer, the whole Iliad and the Odyssey. Students volunteer to take their hour chunk of reading Homer, and they get through the whole Iliad and Odyssey over the course of the night. And they have a small crowd of people who sit there all night and just listen to Homer. These are the types of things, though, that are done by people who love what they're learning. These are the things that are done by students. So I hope I've made my first point very clear. That the first way to explain what is a classic school is by making a point that in such a place, both students and teachers have a craving for knowledge. The second way to answer this question, which gets me into this, what is a classic school? I think it can be summed up into a few words. Okay, it is a place where the educational mission is to train students to become masters of language. It's a place where the educational mission is to train students to become masters of language. What do I mean by this? Well, you and I engage in language and meaning on a day-to-day basis. Sometimes it's through art, sometimes it's through music, sometimes it's through mathematics. In fact, this is why we keep these things as a part of the classical curriculum, because they are languages through which ideas of beauty and order and perfection can become manifest. And while we speak through these mediums, some people better than others, we all engage most frequently in our own primary language, which for most of us here is English. And so I think that a classical school aims to make each of its students as good at this language as possible. It sounds kind of like a progressive idea, doesn't it? To make your kids good at something that they'll probably use every day for the rest of their lives. So we'd be right to ask, how does the classical model of education try to make us masters of language? And the first answer that we have to this is the Trivium. You know, the methodology of the grammar stage for the youngest of kids, the logic stage for the middle schoolers, and the rhetoric stage for the high schoolers. And of course, we teach other languages to help one become better at understanding the English language, whether it's Latin, art, music, speech. The idea is that this rigorous methodology will allow the kids, after they are through with it, to be equipped with an understanding of grammar, building blocks for future thinking, to have an understanding of how to use language logically, and to have a knowledge of how to use and defend themselves against rhetoric, should there be a need to do so. It's a pretty cool method, because it works as a system, because it provides a pretty solid foundation. And I think that because it works as a system, it provides, or should provide, a lot of these opportunities, a lot of moments where overlap between the grammar stage and the logic stage, or the logic stage and the rhetoric stage, or even the grammar stage and the rhetoric stage, where there's moments of overlap between these things. And because the Trivium is spread out throughout 12 years, a lot of times it's easy for students and even teachers to miss connections that can be made. Can you remember having a moment where everything sort of comes together through this one single moment? Perhaps in a movie or a book. Right now my friends and I are watching the Harry Potter series, so I thought about, with Harry Potter when you finally find out that Snape has been the good guy who just really loves Harry Potter the whole time because of his mother. And this moment of realization allows you to reinterpret every single moment that they encounter each other throughout every book that came before it. I think that this is the kind of moment that students really enjoy having, because in just one moment, many pieces of knowledge become part of a relationship, and they take on a new and deeper meaning. And it's a time where what you actually know becomes even more valuable, because it all works together. So I think it should be typical for a classical student, really all students, to be encountering these kinds of moments as much as possible. So I designed a class that aims at bringing these kinds of moments to the student. I was asked today to present on a class that I teach, which my 8th grade students and I call Trivium. The idea for this class was created very simply through sitting down and brainstorming with our headmaster. As I studied philosophy in Latin and Greek at Hillsdale, naturally the subject for which I have the most passion for is the philosophy of language. In other words, questions such as how does someone or something participate in meaning? Is meaning contextual or inherent in the thing itself? And of course, the relativist today wants to deny that anything can have an inherent meaning, or therefore be absolutely good or absolutely beautiful. Another question, just to give you an idea of the philosophy of language, is how does English, as my primary language, affect my life on a day-to-day basis in comparison to if I spoke a different language? I have a friend from India who studied with me in England, and I found it interesting because she's in England, she's living English, and from her family, her familial context, she speaks this Indian dialect. So, and I find this to be an interesting question to ask people who have the capability to speak two languages as though they are, you know, living in it. I asked, well, do you ever notice a time when you're speaking English, and then you go from English to D&D and dialect, where you notice a personality shift? And she said, well, that's an interesting question, and I think I can answer it. When there are words, so she said, there are words and grammar in the Indian dialect which allow me to express respect with my peers or my elders, and we just don't have these words and this grammar in English. So when I'm speaking English, I actually feel a lot more loose and free to just kind of address people as though they were all equals. It's these kind of things. You know, if we're speaking English, how is this actually affecting our personality? I find this fascinating. So theologically, I find that the negative theology of Aquinas is a very interesting idea in regard to our language. I don't know, you know how much of our language can actually map itself onto a being as complicated as God must be. So these are the things that are part of my greatest interest. It made sense to create an opportunity to share this wonder with the students that I teach. Our headmaster was keen on our eighth graders taking a logic course. Our middle school curriculum dictates that the eighth graders have a course on grammar. And I, having done a bit of debate in college, was interested in teaching on rhetoric a little bit, primarily Aristotelian rhetoric. So what I did this, and also there's a lot of classical schools right now that only go through eighth grade, and you know it's really a blessing to be a classical school that goes through 12th grade, because you get to fully dive into the rhetoric stage of thinking. So the other thought behind this class is, look, it's a time for our eighth graders to kind of just immerse themselves in a little bit of the rhetoric, that just get a taste for it, for some knowledge of what they'll be able to use their grammar and their logic preparation to do. So this past year, what I did and will continue to do this year is teach a class called Trivium. Now the idea of Trivium is to juxtapose many familiar but sometimes new ideas to my students in order to convey many moments of overlap on the subjects of grammar, logic, and rhetoric, which I said earlier is what I think the students will find naturally interesting. So, how do we do this? Well, I'll explain the format and the order of how the class goes throughout the year to give you kind of a broad perspective. And then we'll spend some time digging through a few of the things that I went through with the kids last year. This will be primarily in my second presentation during our first semester, but there'll be things focused on the first semester. It makes much more sense to do it this way, to just take you through a few of the things that we've done, rather than talk about the class abstractly with the little time that we have here today. I don't know if the point of this presentation is to say, hey, go out and teach a Trivium class, maybe. As much as it is, though, it's focused on making a couple of points. The one is the classical education really does lend itself to making its students better at using language than students who are not equipped with classical education. And two, if you teach or are thinking about teaching classes at a classical school, I hope this presentation offers you a chance to consider how your classes might actually aim at increasing your students' understanding of language. And I hope that you will walk away with a few more ideas on how to do so. So our academic year goes in four quarters, like many. We spend the first two of those quarters, which will be the focus for the rest of my time here, with a brief introduction to me, and an introduction to the questions, what is grammar, what is logic, and what is rhetoric, and how do these subjects lend themselves to a better understanding of meaning itself? And this provides a foundation for a two-week learning cycle then that follow for the rest of the semester. Each two-week cycle has its own focus, which provides the ground for all of the overlap that should take place. Again, these moments of excitement, I think. So in each of these two-week cycles, we spend the first week focused on one aspect of grammar, more particularly, one of the eight great parts of speech. The second week, we spend the first half of that week on how the grammar that we just covered plays a role in logic. And then the latter half of the week, we spend talking about how both the grammar and the logic that we just covered plays a role in rhetoric. So if that sounds weird, don't worry, I'll show you what I mean in a bit. And the second lecture is going to involve a bit more of a hands-on approach to this. So we spend the first half of the year figuring out how the eight great parts of English speech play a role in the logic and rhetoric of English. And quarter three, we do a few lessons on formal logic. And then start to look at and analyze great pieces of rhetoric that are found throughout history. And then we talk about what makes them great. The fourth quarter, one that we had a lot of fun with this past year, we read book two of Aristotle's rhetoric, a lot of it. And in book two, there's a large section of text which is focused on using rhetoric for the purpose of evoking an emotional response out of your audience. So we read and discuss what each emotion is, like friendship, you know, envy, whatnot, and we read then Aristotle tells us about the type of person that can have this kind of an emotion, and then how to evoke it out of such a person. So so together in class I bring in some literature that agrees or disagrees with it, with what Aristotle says. We talk about that, and every week the kids are responsible for writing their own speech that must attempt to evoke the emotion that we're studying out of their classmates and myself in a way that Aristotle tells them to do it. You can imagine just how funny this gets sometimes when the emotion for the week is something like jealousy or hatred. sometimes the classes just end very tense, but that's how it's supposed to be. So that's the yearly overview. And it brings me to a point where I will start to introduce some of the things that we teach as a part of the Trivium as a class. So we start out the year with the question of what is meaning? This is a question that I like to start out asking because at the beginning of the year, I like to start at the beginning because, first of all, who asks that? We as good Lutherans are typically accustomed to asking, what does this mean? But here we're not asking for a more detailed explanation of a phrase that could be ambiguous. We're asking more generally, what is meaning itself? It's not a typical question. So it's a weird question. It's a good question to introduce the kids to the idea that even though they are eighth graders, they don't know everything there is to know. And they don't even know everything there is to ask. I was talking earlier about the classical school being a place where students crave knowledge. You can't crave something that you already think you have. But I begin the class by asking this because it remains thematic throughout the year, and I comfort the kids by telling them not to worry after they take a few guesses if they haven't the slightest idea how to answer the question, because the whole year is going to be focused on answering this question. And at the end of the year, it's my hope that if they should hear this question again, they'll be just as befuddled. But at this point, not because they don't understand the question, but because they understand how complicated this question is to answer. I think that the question has to be at the forefront of any class on language, because before we can begin talking about how one can mean effectively, that is, how one can use language effectively, we have to start by wondering, what is meaning itself? Sort of this question, what is meaning? We start the class with this one lesson. It's a pretty silly demonstration, unless you start to think about it. I asked for a volunteer, and I have that person go outside of the room, and I say to the class, okay, I chose Tyler because I don't want him to know about this, but I can actually move things around the room without touching him. And the kids all just sit there and thinking this is a joke, or that I'm some sort of undercover wizard. And I say, I'll prove it to you. But you cannot say a word to Tyler, even when he comes back into the room. So this marks our agreement. That sounds like a deal, right? And I call Tyler back into the room, and as he's coming in, I say, hey, bring me that pencil off my desk. And here, as he's bringing this pencil to me, I have my proof that I can actually move things around my room without actually touching them. Which, of course, is disappointing to the magic show that they thought was coming. Now this is, it's a short and silly little thing, right? But how does this help us answer the original question, what is meaning? Well, I think it's a good way of demonstrating that meaning is something that changes the world, a world that is both inside of us and outside of us. You can see that my ability to mean led the kids to change their state of being from one just sitting and listening to me to a state of sitting and actually expecting something from me. And you can see that my ability to mean, it left the physical world in a different place, at the very least with a pencil. So I think that it's important to start out our exploration of meaning and language by contemplating how powerful of a tool that language actually is. This is a quick video. that I like. It makes a good analogy to the Passover demonstration. If you haven't seen this movie, please do. It's excellent. But this is a short clip that will be helpful to our purposes. Okay. Thank you.
Almighty says this must be a fashionable fight. It's drawn the finest people. Where is thy salute?
For presenting yourselves on this battlefield. I give you thanks. This is our army. To join it, you give homage.
I give homage to Scotland. And if this is your army, why does it go?
We didn't come here to fight for them.
Oh, the English are too many.
Wallace is 7 feet tall.
Yes, I've heard. He killed men by the hundred. And if he were here, he'd consume the English with fireballs from his eyes and bolts of lightning from his arse. I am William Wallace. And I see a whole army of my countrymen here in defiance of tyranny. You've come to fight as free men. And free men you are. What will you do without freedom? Will you fight?
Fight against that?
No!
We will run!
And we will live. Aye. Fight and you may die. Run. And you'll live. At least a while. And dying in your bed, many years from now, would you be willing to trade all the days from this day to that for one chance, just one chance, to come back here and tell our enemies that they may take our lives, but they'll never take our freedom!
I like this because even though it's just a part of the story in this movie, it's a perfect analogy to the pencil demonstration. Here it's not just a dumb pencil being moved to the other side of a room. This is a whole army of men being moved to the other side of a battlefield. And so you can start to get in, just start to get a little deeper into this question now. What is meaning? As you unravel the first suggestion, it's something that changes the world. I think it's good to take a step back and look every once in a while at language like this. I like this part in the Aeneid where the Trojan horse is waiting outside the city gate. And the Trojan king, Priam, we all know the Trojan horse story. Priam, the Trojan king, says, what's going on here with this horse outside our gates? Big wooden horse. And it's at this time that the Trojan soldiers bring in this captured war slave named Sinon, and he fumbles in. He's got this beautiful story about how the Greeks were going to sacrifice him, and he's running away. He now hates them, and he's just here because he just wants to gain the ally of the Trojans. And we find out later that Sinon has basically just arranged to be captured so that he could give this marvelously rhetorical pity speech to Priam, so that he could persuade Priam that the horse was actually a gift for the Trojan gods. And Priam rightfully asks. He says, what's the catch here? That the Greeks are snakes. And Sinon explains that Priam's perfectly right to wonder about Greek trickery. That in fact, the whole stunt is laden with Greek trickery, because the Greeks tried to build a horse so big that the Trojans wouldn't be able to get it into their city gates, and thus they'd offend their gods, and then their gods might abandon them. We'll hear him. Priam hears this. And it all makes sense. Sinon has covered all the bases that he needed to cover in order to get this horse full of Greek warriors into the city. And Virgil has this beautiful set of lines that mark how significant of a moment this is. This is 195 through 198 in the Aeneid, obviously translated. Through these tricks and the skill of the liar Sinon, the horse was credited. And we were trapped, all because of his cunning words and false tears. We, Trojans, who were not conquered by Diomede, nor Larissa and Achilles, nor by the 10 years of the Trojan War, nor the 1,000 ships right outside our coast. None of these physical things trapped us. What trapped us was his words. He trapped us into thinking that we were in the right to let this horse in. And I love this example because it brings an ethical element into the question. What is meaning? This is the power that we have as human beings. The power that we have with language, with meaning. It's something that can be used for good or for evil. And we'll read this whole excerpt between Sinon and Priam class. And at the end, I'll ask, who wants to be friends with Sinon? No one raises their hand, we have a perfect example of two things. One, of how brilliant the story Virgil tells to make every last Greek look like a scumbag. You just have this guy, you know, straddling off. Of all people, you think this guy could be one of the last good Greeks. No, even he's a stumbler. And not only this, but we realize that through this, we have to be careful about the things that we say. And not only because the things that we say can change the world to be a worse place, but because people are always listening to your words, and you're always being judged on account of the things that you say. Just like we all sat around and came to a conclusion about Sinon on account of the words that had come out of his mouth more than a couple thousand years later than he said them. And these are fun examples of how meaning can change something as big as wars that determine the whole outcome of history. But to you and to me, the significance of language is much more immediate and tangible than wars that happened a long time ago. Things that you say and the way that you say them, the way that you mean, it affects every relationship that you have on a day-to-day basis. Think about your best friendships and the people that you very much dislike. And think about how your perception of these people depends or has depended on the things that you said to them and the things that they said to you. I love you, or I hate you. It's words that sort of metaphysically bind us or divide us. So I'd like to start with thinking out about this. Because we have this ability to speak, to mean, not only that, but we have the potential to get better at speaking, to get better at our language, to get better at our way of meaning what we want to mean. And the kids in seventh grade, they go through informal logic, logical fallacies, and they see firsthand that if they're not very good at language, the logic of language, they can fall into the traps that are set for people who are not very good at language. So I start with these things because our whole year's focus on language and meaning. And to spend a whole year of life on something means that it better be important. And no matter who you are, if you speak a language, the outcome of your life is going to be very influenced by the things that you say and the way that you say them. So it seems like this is one of the most important things that we can study. Because through a careful study of language, we come to control it better. And as a result, we can come to control the world around us, for better or for worse. So to go back to something that I said earlier, that classical education is an education that's focused on creating masters of language, you can start to see the value of this kind of education, one that demands a rigorous understanding of grammar, one that pushes the students to understand languages like Latin that enrich our vocabulary and provide deep insight into English, an education that forces a student to consider the logic and the logical fallacies of his or her own language. It's the type of education that taught our founding fathers, like Jefferson, Albert Einstein, Martin Luther, Shakespeare, Darwin, Marx, some of the most revolutionary thinkers in the entire Western world. These were figures that are famous for what they wrote down, the way that they used language. They changed the world through what they said, through what they were able to mean. So this thing that we call meaning, it really is a beautiful thing. It's something that I think one could really spend a whole lifetime just finding joy at the process of thinking about. But you know, to be a conservative, and I'm not trying to make this political, but it means to be a type of person who has seen and discovered many beautiful things, many beautiful ideas in the world, ideas that are so beautiful that you want to conserve them, and to keep them from dying, to protect them as timeless. So that the generation that comes after us can see and appreciate the beauty that we saw in our generation. But as this kind of conservative, I think that teaching people how to mean in a way that they want to mean is pretty important for the whole conservative cause. Because think about it. As a conservative, one believes in timeless principles, whether it's freedom, beauty, justice, divine love, and we're finite beings. So to pass these things on, to make them things that people want to pass on, it requires us to be able to talk about them well. It requires us to be successful at the task of not only seeing something beautiful, but holding on to it and giving it to someone in a way that they will also see it as beautiful. We can do this through language. So the second part of the lecture, which will take part after our break, it'll dive into the question, how is meaning created? And we'll go into a little analysis about grammar, logic, and rhetoric. And then we'll do some activities that bring these things all together to answer our first question and this question. But before I end this part, quickly, I want us to think about language as the mechanism that lets us pass an idea from one person to the next. I think there has to be some correlation between a culture that's conservative and a culture that is good at language. Because being good at language means that you have a better capability of preserving ideas. You see epic poetry, books and books, memorized and passed on generationally by cultures that partake in oral tradition. During this time, you get Greek and Roman virtues, ways of being that become inherent parts of living well. You can look back at the work of scribes, creating hundreds of thousands of things that are worth their very lives to pass on. So it might be a little concerning, I think, to the conservatives that we live in a time where it's popular to disregard grammar, to teach kids how to spell however they want to because it'll make them feel better for a moment, to live in a culture that doesn't care to teach logic, to live in a culture where taking debate in high school is nerdy. It should be concerning to the conservative that we live in a culture that doesn't really care at becoming good at language, because we have computers and technology to remember everything for us. So I want to end this lecture by praising an old teacher of mine who took this question that I had been considering, what is meaning? And he brought it a step further for me than it just being something that changes the world. He brought to life the idea that meaning is something that we can actually capture, something that we should want to capture if it changes the world, if the change that it brings brings a good change in order to share it with others. And I saw him do this as I was working with him. He's one of the finest scholars on Euripides in the world, an ancient tragedian. And every year he puts together a play, an old Greek tragedy or a comedy. And the year that I worked with him, he chose the Bacchae. These plays are special because they're translated by him personally. And he uses all of his classic students to make the plays happen. I was a drummer for this play, so I got to talk to him quite a bit, in quite a bit of detail about how he made his translation. Because the Bacchae has a chorus that comes in and chants in a Greek rhythm, a Greek meter. So it was my job to keep this rhythm on the drum, as the Bacchans chanted along in his English translation. As a student of Homer and Virgil, you come up with translations and you're just trying to make sense and convey the sense of what's being said in the poem line by line. But this guy had such a talent that he was able to keep the Greek meter in his English translation. And by doing so, he was able to preserve the meaning of these chorus parts in a way that I would never have thought was possible in a translation. And the effect that this has during the presentation is indescribable. Let me show you the difference between one example of a published version of the Bacchae and our teacher's translation. You can flip to the end here, the last page in your packet, we have the one right. If you flip to the back, you see this. If you flip the back page over, you get another sheet of text. It looks like this. Okay, so this is the sectioned off piece is what will be. You'll see this in this translation and the next one. Okay, this is a good translation though. Blessed is the happy man who knows the mysteries of the gods ordained and sanctifies his life, joined soul with soul in mystic unity, and by due ritual made pure, enters the ecstasy of mountain solitudes, who observes the mystic rites made lawful by Cybele, the great mother, who crowns his head with ivy and shakes aloft his wand in worship of Dionysus. On, on, run, dance, delirious, possessed. Dionysus comes to his own. Bring from the Phrygian hills to the broad streets of Hellas the god, child of a god, spirit of revel and rapture, Dionysus. Once on the womb that held him, the firebolt flew from the hand of Zeus and pains the childbirth bound by his mother, and pains the childbirth bound his mother fast, and she cast him forth untimely, and under the lightning flash relinquished life. And Zeus, the son of Cronus, ensconced him instantly in a secret womb, chambered within his thigh, and with golden pins closed him from Hera's sight. Okay, so you get this is translated from Greek. Now this is our teacher's translation. And as you flip to the last page in here, this is so what this is showing you is this is bringing you something from the Greeks. The meter that they use in their own language. It is very difficult to do, but it has been done here. So I'll start out, and I'll pound. This is annoying, I know. It was done with a drum in the actual play, but I'll give you a sense of the rhythm here, so you can follow along. Blessed is he, richly blessed, if he knows the God's mysteries, if he makes his life holy, joins in the dance with heart and soul, if he worships on the mountains with holy lustrations, who engages in all the rituals of Cybele, the mighty mother, or with thrice as high brandished and crowned with wreaths of ivy, pays worship to Dionysus. On ye Bacchae, as you bring down Dionysus, the divine child of the Greek god, whose voice booms like the thunder from the mountains of Phrygia to the wild floors ways of Greece. Fast in the grip of childbirth pain, was your mother long days since when the thunder both clapped and shot from the womb she brought you forth. You can see through this how the Greek meter is brought through into the English. This is something that is amazing. Because it gives us something very difficult to give. So we'll end our consideration of the question, what is meaning, here at this point, with an understanding that meaning is not only something that changes the world, but it's something that plays a key role in preserving the world as we know it. It brings us to something that plays a key role in preserving the world as we know it. And it is a very hard and difficult process to mean well. But in a classical school, we come to find that strength rejoices in that challenge. Thank you. Any questions or... ridiculing?
Yes. A couple things. One, I know that the common response to this would be, well, you can't do this with 7th and 8th grade.
Okay.
But in our experience with rural kids, farmers, small industry, that's what makes up our population. If we expect it of them, they will enter into it.
Yes.
And if we have it with joy and excitement that you do, they will enter into it.
Yes.
And this is true all up through into the university and college, which was your experience.
Correct.
It's what we expect of them. Mm-hmm. Because if we expect that they think it's going to be a party at the university, then it's going to be a party, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
It's not going to be serious study. So it comes down to what we expect of them. And, you know, folks have asked why we make our kids do this kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And I remind them in the rural context that the Lincoln and Douglas debates, which were complicated debates about constitutionality of states' rights and slavery, mm-hmm. it was all heard by farmers who all understood the debate mm-hmm. and understood the vocabulary. and understood the depth of meaning, of philosophy, and were able to talk about it. And so, why can't we do that with our kids? And this kind of thing for 7th and 8th graders, if you present it to them the way you do, and you have teachers who are able to do that, they will eat this up. And it will be all the better.
It's a fun class.
Certainly.
Thank you. Yeah, of course. Yes,
again. I just wanted testimony. My daughter is in this Graf class, and she's in 7th grade, and this summer she wanted to read Aristotle to prepare for Trivium.
Right.
Yes. So, okay. Well, thank you for all. Thank you all for coming. And we'll have our second lecture at 3:15.